実はですね、私は一宮町の NPO 法人さすが一宮の理事長を務めさせていただいている白信子と申します。もうね、この建物はね、昨年本当は壊されてしまう予定だったんですね。でも少しでもこれは素晴らしい、二度と建てることのできない日本建築だと思いまして、 NPO の皆さん仲間と一緒に町長さんの力もですけども、こう保存することができました。
For the Global Study Program, you can hear me now, I guess. Okay. This is Ms. Shida Nobuko, who's head of this NPO, and who bought this house more than a year ago, I think, because it was crumbling apart, and she bought it and to renovate it. And she thank you all for coming today and contributing to this. Ichinomiya's revitalization plans.
ただ冷房がなくてごめんなさいって
。続いてじゃあ町長さんのお話をお願いします。This is the mayor of Ichinomiya.
皆さんおはようございます。
Good morning.
My name is 玉川。まず皆さんですね、アリストテレス大学の皆さん、ようこそ Ichinomiya へおいでいただきました。ヨーロッパ文明の起源はですね、ギリシャと言われておりますのギリシャからですね、有名な哲学者のアリストテレスの大学ということで、大変私たちは光栄だと思っております。
So again, thank you for coming today from all the far away from Greece, and we have heard of Aristotle, and we are very proud to have people from this civilization, and we're really happy to have you here for this collaborative program that will hopefully contribute to revitalization of the town. So have a look at our history and our cultural resources, and hopefully we learn from each other today. Okay. Next is in English.
Yes.
Next it's Professor Morris. Basically, when we were looking for a project to include in this program, Professor Mo- we kind of contacted Professor Morris, and he kindly introduced us to this project, and he's supporting us for the last of 3 or 4 months. We have come with him today here. He's a professor of the history of architecture at the Faculty of Engineering at Chiba University, and he's been researching in Ichinomiya since 2008.
Yes, 2007.
Right? 2007. So, if someone knows Ichinomiya, it's probably Professor Morris.
Yep, still there are many, many things I don't know, but one or two buildings I've had a chance to have a look at.
Okay. So, we have first a lecture by Professor Morris about the work here in Ichinomiya.
Okay, so and I have an hour for this. No, yes. Or rather, 45 minutes, because my students are doing a presentation at the end.
All right, so for 45 minutes, and then we have a presentation by Professor Morris,
two of my students, yes?
Okay.
Yeah, thank you very much. Hang on, now if I switch this, I do. De これが... Doesn't seem to be working, does it? I shan't worry about that. Can you hear me? Yep, okay. Revitalizing Ichinomiya through its historic architecture, building on the past is a grand title I gave myself. It will sort of follow that. I'm Martin Morris, and I was introduced to Chiba University Graduate School of Engineering, and I teach history of architecture and conservation. So looking at the Japanese archipelago, Chiba is here, and we are in Ichinomiya on the other side of the Borso Peninsula, which is just here. Welcome to Ichinomiya. To tell you something, to put things in perspective, let me start by saying things you already know. Japan is one of the great economic success stories of modern times. following a century of revolution which overthrew the shoguns and ostensibly returned power to the country's ancient imperial house in 1868, Japan turned itself into a Western-style economic and military superpower, prepared to challenge the West for control of Eastern Asia in a little over half a century. Crushing military defeat was followed by a renunciation of war and energetic reconstruction, leading, thanks to access to world markets, to the creation within a few decades of the world's third largest economy. World leaders in heavy industry and then in fields demanding the highest levels of skill, cars, electronics, computers, etc., Japan created a sophisticated, high-density, urbanized, middle-class society, which successfully hosted the Olympics back in the 60s and is about to do so again, and international exhibitions, until success inflated a bubble that burst in the late 1980s. In the process, the Japanese created the world's largest megalopoly and plains of irreversible urban sprawl. Well, this is the view from the Mori Tower looking towards Fujisan in the distance out across the Kanto plain, and as far as the eye can see, the great metropolis spreads onwards. Overall, with Yokohama and as far as Chiba, including everything, I believe it's about 43 million people. So Japan after the ball. The years since 1989 have seen economic stagnation, falling birth rate, aging population, and now falling population. Continuing migration of young people to major urban centers, corresponding decline in regions away from the major centers, general emptying of the countryside, now disproportionately occupied by elderly people, aggregation of production and distribution of goods into the hands of larger and larger organizations, functioning as national or international chains and making their profits by operating within tight margins. This puts local suppliers out of business. Localities cease to be self-sustaining. An example is much of the Borsal Peninsula. An idyllic landscape, but soon no one to maintain it. Points of departure for what follows. History is not only about the past, it contexts the present and the future. We assume that progress is linear and proceeds from less to more sophisticated, but is this true? Every advance involves abandoning something, often something that was viable and worthwhile. The way past cultures have done things may be of value for the future. It's cultural chauvinism to write the past off. Keeping old buildings as cultural properties is a way of retaining artifacts. The idea of keeping whole settlements and now landscapes expands the concepts. Things cannot be kept on that scale without conserving ways of living, i.e. cultures. Conceptual thinking resembling that which theoretically underlies England's national trust. Declining localities are repositories of past cultures. They represent a great opportunity. We might aim for their holistic, though not entirely unedited, resurrection as viable, sustainable communities, parallel worlds to which people can move to experience other modes of being. Conservation of these regions may be humanity's lifeline if the unsustainable modernist cities crash. Preliminaries. Exploring the problem in a specific context. At the initial stage, the role of my field, architectural history, is clearly defined. We can put a place in historical perspective and highlight what is special about it. We can survey and record its built heritage. We can appraise the structures we have recorded from the standpoints of historical importance and potential for reuse. We can point to other cases where historic environments have contributed to enhancing a sense of identity and prosperity. As a case study in this activity, I shall discuss this small rural town in the hinterland of Borsal, Ichinomiya-cho. But let me first introduce its four main historic elements. The mayor mentioned some of this, but first of all, we have what the Japanese call a monzen machi, that is to say, a town before gates. The gates of what? The gates of... that was supposed to do something that's not going to do. Yes, it is. Here we have the jinja that he mentioned, the shrine, Ichinomiya's shrine, Tamasaki Jinja. And here we have a major temple of the Tendai sect called Kamyoji, which at one time managed this shrine. We also have a town along a route. The route is the route which historically ran along this side, the eastern side of the Borsal Peninsula, and then turned inland and is heading towards the center of the Kanto and ultimately towards Tokyo. And a town has grown up along that route. That's another major element. And this is one of the houses which line that route, which goes back through time to the various early stages of the existence of this state in Japan. And then we have, this was the area where the samurai lived. It's now more or less lost that character. A castle was established here briefly in the period of the Country of War, which is back in the 16th century, but that didn't last very long. Much later, in the 18th century, a small fief was established here to support a family who were actually officials at the Shogun's court. And they had their officials running this land which they were given to support them. Then we have the station. And the station is vital because the station provides access to Chiba and to Tokyo. You can get to Tokyo in an hour from here using the express. You can get to Chiba in 40 minutes using the rapid service. So, connections. Then, the center of the settlement is Kazusa Ichinomiya. Kazusa is the name of the province. Ichinomiya means first shrine. This was the number one shrine in Kazusa province, and its name is Tamasaki Shrine, Tamasaki Jinja. And its central buildings, the worship hall, the Haiden, and the building behind it, the Honden, are the oldest surviving buildings in this settlement, dating back to 1687. They constitute together a good example of the shrine style called Gongen-zukuri. And to the side of them, there is also a small building where offerings, food offerings, are prepared to be given to the deities worshipped here. This is an etching of the shrine made in 1894. There are many of these etchings which survive from that period. Individual house owners, particularly business owners, and the people who were running institutions such as shrines and temples had them made, and they are remarkably accurate in terms of the way they show buildings within the structure. The surroundings are a bit more freely composed, but for the part in the center, they're usually extremely accurate. And we can see the shrine's worship hall and the hall where the deity is ensconced, just as they are today. And the basic layout of the shrine, as you will find when you explore it, is pretty much as this illustrates. Regarding these shrines, if we go back to the foundation of the Yamato state, its central areas are the area around Nara and Kyoto today, Kawachi, Narama, Asuka, and Yamashiro. And from there, the state expanded eastwards. Already they had accumulated the lands to the west, expanding eastward from the 5th and 6th centuries. But already before that, probably from here, traders were traveling along this coastline. And we have a number of shrines. I want to bring these in. A number of shrines along this coast. Issei is one very famous one. Issei was founded by the local ruling class, probably, and then taken over by Yamato as it expanded eastwards. But some other shrines, Mishima Taisha, which originally was on the east side of the Izu Peninsula, and then Kazusa Ichinomiya Tamasaki Jinja on the east side of the Borsal Peninsula. A little further north up river is Katori Jingu, further north again on the coast is Kashima Jingu. It is quite likely that this group of shrines were actually founded by people traveling along the coast to trade, and when the Yamato state expanded and took over these regions, expanding by land, these shrines possibly pre-existed and were then taken into the state as the Yamato Empire developed and gradually pushed its way until it extended right up to the north of Honshu. So that's the kind of context against which we can understand the importance of this site. It wasn't the center of the province, it was the place where the main shrine of the province was located. But at a slightly later stage in the province's history, the centralized government system begins to disintegrate. And as we enter the medieval period, we find a shift which can be seen in other areas as well. I've taken the example here of Suo province, which is further to the west, where the original center of the provincial administration basically declines as we go into the medieval period, the 12th century and thereabouts, and in its place, the first shrine of the province becomes the most important institution, and the road linking the shrine down to the coast at this point becomes the center of activity, and there's a port down here, and markets held before the gates of the shrine, and probably something quite similar happened here. So this community became increasingly important in the medieval period, and a kind of center of the vitality of Kasusa province as the ancient state disintegrated. If we look at the arrangement of the shrine, this arrangement with a worship hall at the front and a main hall for what the Japanese call a honden, where the deity is enshrined, to the rear, and then a linking structure or a linking roof between them known as an ishinoma. That arrangement is one quite common arrangement for larger shrines, and it first emerges, as far as we know, towards the end of the Heian period, about the 11th and 12th centuries, and the earliest clear example that we know is a shrine in Kyoto called Kitano Tenmangu, and that shrine has this layout. It was later adopted by the Tokugawa family for their family mausoleum at Nikko. So Nikko is also designed according to this arrangement, and is, as probably those of you who have read about these things know, extremely beautifully decorated with gilding and with lacquer and so forth. The shrine we have here also is similar to tomorrow, I think, no, the day after tomorrow you're going to Sawara, I believe. Sawara has a big shrine just outside it called Katori Jingu, which again takes a very similar form to the one at Ichinomiya and is also lacquered black as the one at Ichinomiya is. So Ichinomiya's shrine is part of that family of shrines, and historically interesting. It's also a very busy shrine at New Year and at festival times. A lot of the people in the peninsula come to this as a place for worship. At New Year, thousands descend on it, and it's very busy. And people come here to have their families blessed, their cars blessed. It's religious, still has a religious function, but it also organizes its festivals, and it's a symbolic focus for the community. Next to it, and just opposite on the road, there's still a large area. This is another one of these copper plate etchings made at the turn of the 20th century, and it shows the entire site of the temple that stands opposite the shrine, a little bit sort of you can't immediately see it, but this temple was obviously a major temple. It belongs to the Tendai sect, and it's far bigger the actual overall site is far bigger than one would expect for the size of the buildings, which are all that survive. There aren't many buildings there now. It must once have been much more important, and we know that they had the stewardship of Tamasaki Jinja back in earlier centuries. So they were responsible for actually running the shrine for certain parts of its history. That sort of temple, there are a number of them in the Kanto, but one of the ones that you might have heard of, a much larger scale example but still interesting, is in Tokyo, Asakusa. Sensoji is the name of the temple. Sensoji is actually the oldest thing really in Tokyo. I mean, the buildings are not old now, but it was there before Tokyo was there. And in front of its gates, there was a street with shop houses and market space and so forth, and they had their own craftsmen and their own institutions in the medieval period. And Kanyoji must have been a small version of something like this. This is a representation of it made in the late 17th, possibly early 18th century, which shows it not precisely accurately, but gives a sense of what it was like at that stage. We also had a castle in Ichinomiya briefly in the Sengoku period, which would have been something along these lines, with ditches the top of the hill, which lies over there, defended. But this castle was nipped in the bud by surrounding daimyos, who decided they didn't want Ichinomiya to get too powerful, so they stopped it. At that stage, that castle came to an end. And they also destroyed the shrine and the temple, and all of those institutions had to rebuild in the early Edo period. Sadly, they also, in that process, lost all of their historic records. So for reconstructing the medieval history, we're thrown back to some extent upon guesswork. I want to briefly talk about the background and the investigation of a building that led to the foundation of the MPO Sasuga Ichinomiya, which Shida Nobuko-san leads, and which has been responsible for purchasing this house at a time when it looked as though it was going to be demolished, in order to save it and in order to make a focus for activities of a cultural nature in the town, and also activities which might lead to the conservation of more of the surviving architecture. Basically, we can say that the castle site has only vestigial earthworks. Kanmyoji has few surviving buildings, and the main hall of the temple, the Hondo, was rebuilt in reinforced concrete, so although it has its form is reflects its earlier form, it isn't actually a timber frame building anymore. But Tamasaki Jinja has a range of ancillary structures, and it was one of those that was the catalyst that led to the establishment of the MPO in the winter of 2007. Briefly, this is a page from the 2006 report on post-Edo period Japanese style buildings in Chiba Prefecture. The Japanese have long been conscious of their older timber frame buildings and their historic value. This was something, the idea of keeping some of the older temples goes back to the end of the 19th, beginning of the 20th century, as the Japanese state was beginning to organize itself as a modern state. To a considerable extent, it was they were influenced by people like Ernest Fenollosa, an Italian who was looking at Japanese, he was in Japan and cooperating with the Japanese, and he started looking at Buddhist statues and things like that, and from the Buddhist statues looking at the buildings that contained the Buddhist statues, and starting the process of deciding what was old and what wasn't, and what the history of all this was, because nobody had really sorted it, and that process really began then. But it's much more recent that buildings which post-date the major revolution in 1868 have started to be looked at seriously. And now, well, in Chiba it was around 2000, and the report was finally issued in 2006, that they really started looking at those relatively recent Japanese style buildings in this prefecture and saying, what should we keep? What's important? What's historic? What is there? No one had really done that until that point. And this is the page which looks at Tamasaki Jinja, and in particular it's the ancillary buildings to the shrine, including the main shrine office building. But one of the buildings they picked up was this one, which is Hakujuan, which was the former shrine office of the shrine. And this is that building as it appears in the 1894 etching of Tamasaki Jinja. You can see a small building with a hipped and gabled tiled roof in one side. Up here is the place where the Honden and Heiden are. You'll see this later. In this building is clearly shown at that stage. And it's labelled here Shamisho, which means shrine office. It was known as Hakujuan, that's its name, and it was erected in 1885. This is a photo taken probably around 1930. In front of it is a tree. When you go to the shrine, you can still see this tree, but you won't see this building. In 1940, Hakujuan was replaced. This is the whole of Tamasaki Jinja. Here is the Heiden and the Honden. So this is the central group. Tamasaki, all of this is Tamasaki Jinja. Hakujuan originally stood just here. That's this building, standing here, and it was in 1940 they decided to build a new shrine office, and they moved Hakujuan about 50 yards north to a new position where it stood for 67 years, and that's it. In 2007, they decided they needed a new reception building for the shrine as a whole, and they decided to demolish Hakujuan. That's what Hakujuan looked like at that stage, as it stood here. They'd taken its tiles off, but the roof was secured. It was covered in galvanized iron and kept the water out. They decided they were going to demolish it and replace it with a new building, which you will see standing on that site now, which is a new shrine reception building. Anyway, the decision was made that we would try to save Hakujuan, but we couldn't save it on that site, so Shida-san, I was involved in surveying it, Shida-san organized what became the MPO towards the end of that year, and we decided that we would, they let us have the material, the actual timbers of the building. We organized for a local architect who specializes in conservation to take the building apart. We surveyed it first. We surveyed the building. This is one of the drawings that my students made. And we produced plans. Some of it was quite hurried. We also established that this part of the building was old and that some of these bits around the edge had been added or changed later. And a local a builder and architect who is, as I said, a specialist in the conservation of old buildings, Iwase-san, basically organized and superintended the dismantling of the building. So everything was surveyed, we pulled the cover strips off posts which had been altered, and we had a look to see how the building had changed over time, and recorded as much as we could, and it was taken apart, and all the pieces were cleaned, and it was put into store in a stone storehouse, which actually is Shida-san's family home, her mother's home and her brother's home, and they had a stone storehouse which fortunately was empty, and they let us put all the pieces in there. So the building is still there. And after that, we recorded all of the members, particularly the posts. These are the four faces of one post, showing all of the marks on there indicating where timbers had entered. So we got a complete record of how the building went together. And this was done with MOBA Architect Studio. One of their representatives will be talking to you afterwards. They've been very important in organizing the conservation of this building and in looking at the town with us, selecting and looking at buildings which are important, which we have then surveyed and produced reports about and hope that we'll be able to make use of. So all of this was done in collaboration with MOBA Architect Studio. And this is the layout that we reconstructed as the original 1885 layout of the Shrine Office as it was first built. There was something added at this side of the building which we could see had left smoke marks, so there'd been a kitchen of some kind here producing smoke, and at that stage we didn't have the picture, the 1894 etching that I showed you earlier. When we got that, we realized that there was indeed a building there already at that stage, and we think that this was a little kitchen structure. My students and I made a model of the building, which is now displayed in one of the town hall buildings there. And basically, the idea was for us both to explore the building and to understand it, but also to give people a sense of what the character of the building had been, and to encourage them to say, you know, this is worth rebuilding and worth doing something with. This is the building that replaced it, the present Shrine Office. And when one looks at it, one realizes what it was about the previous one which had decided them to get rid of it. Basically, the present Shrine Office has reception rooms and rooms for the staff to use, but it also has a very important element here, which is a counter and a shop from which amulets and things can be sold, where people can come to make appointments for rituals or ceremonies to be carried out on their behalf. And all of that sort of thing is absolutely vital to a Shrine Office today. But the building that we were looking at, its original plan was like this. Later it changed a little bit, but basically it didn't have any of those sorts of facilities. What it really consisted of was a reception room for important visitors and some rooms for the Shrine staff to use for changing, for ceremonially cleansing themselves before they undertook rituals and so forth, and for relaxing in and taking light meals in. So it consisted of those elements, and it wasn't really adequate for a modern Shrine Office. So that, I think, is why they rebuilt and why this building was ceased to be the Shrine Office. But they didn't throw it away. They kept it. They moved it. And when I say they moved it, I mean they literally moved it, which is a remarkable thing to have done, but it was very common with Japanese buildings in those days. They didn't dismantle it. They simply put ropes around it and put rollers underneath, hoiked it up and moved it 50 yards and put it down again. And everything that had been there when they before they moved it, one can see from photographs, nothing, even the little sort of bits of storage that had been put in ad hoc underneath the verandas, that all went as well. So that's what happened to it, but they kept it, and it was then used for a range of things. It was used for a kindergarten, it was used for various meetings and so forth, and they kept it going. Now, where did the design come from became a problem, a historical problem for us and for me, and one that I was interested in. And now, old shrines had a range of ancillary structures which had various names, choya, mandokoroya, saikan, kodachi, misogidokoro, where priests could rest, change, purify themselves and prepare for ceremonies, and stay when they were engaged in lengthy rituals. And these buildings have the character and style of Japanese domestic architecture. So they're really residential buildings, and I was able to find one in a shrine in Shimane Prefecture near Izumo, Hinomisaki Jinja. This shrine was rebuilt in the 1630s and 40s. This is the Heiden and the Honden of one part of it, and there's another part on the other side which doesn't show in this picture. Yes, it does. Here we are. Here, another shrine. So two shrines, and this is the building that they were calling a Misogi Dokoro, and we're using much as we think Hakujuan was originally intended to be used at Tamasaki Jinja. And this is that building, its plan, its exterior. It's in a formal shown style, four bays by six, with a cedar bark gabled and hipped roof. It has an ancillary servery for laying out food offerings for the deity at one end of it here. And this is the exterior. So if we compare that with our little Hakujuan, it's actually Irimoya and quite similar. A high raised floor, again similar. And when we put the plans together, this is Hakujuan, this is that Misogi Dokoro. Basically, we have a big hiroma, sort of reception room at one end, rooms for the shrine attendants to use, and then this servery building, which fits with our little cooking building on the rear of Hakujuan. A very closely similar plan. This plan dates from the early part of the 17th century. Hakujuan was built in 1885, so a lot later, but its historical value isn't just in its building date, it actually preserves a layout which goes back to at least the 17th century. And probably further, because if we compare it, we don't know very much about the layouts of Japanese medieval houses, particularly at the level of the overseers of manors and so forth, warrior class people at that stage. But this is one, this is the original document, and if you redraw it, putting in the information that's written on it, you come up with something like this. And if you compare that with the plan of Hakujuan, you can see that actually it's remarkably close. So it may well be that we are in this little building looking at a residential formula which goes back to medieval times and which a shrine has kept going and was still building at the end of the 19th century. So that's sort of my take as a historian on the historical significance of this little structure. And now there is talk that it may be reconstructed and rebuilt. They may actually re-erect it within the Jinja, which would be brilliant if that could happen. They're talking about putting it to the rear. They have the grounds of the priest manager Tanaka-san, that family no longer. There's no longer a direct line and the house is empty. We had surveyed it, and the shrine are basically going to be able to use that. And it has quite a large plot, so it may well be that we can put Hakujuan up again within that if we can raise the money to do it. And the shrine would like to do that and then to use it more or less as it was originally intended for important visitors, perhaps for some events for people to see. So one's hoping. In addition to that, there are in Ichinomiya quite a lot of houses, and those two we have had a look at. Now these are, this is just a sample, not all of them, that were noted when they made the survey in 2005, which was published in 2006. And in Ichinomiya town, they came up with quite a lot of little houses which they said, yes, these are traditional timber frame houses of some interest. And although they don't add up to an unbroken streetscape, which you might find in some more complete towns which have survived, there's been a fair amount of attrition. Buildings have been demolished and new things have been erected. But still, there are these traditional buildings. In particular, there are two what are called misegura. Misegura are shop, basically shop buildings in the form of storehouses. The Japanese storehouse is a timber frame building with a thick plastered wall, basically on the outside of it, which completely covers the timber structure and is an overall about 30 centimeters in depth. And the idea was to create a fireproof cocoon within which you could keep valuables. Originally, storehouses were therefore not shops, they were set back usually within plots, but we've got two of these buildings surviving in Ichinomiya, one of which, of course, is the building at the front here, of Suyohonke. There's another one around the corner in front of the shrine, which you will probably see later. What were these buildings? When did they emerge? Well, the storehouses emerged in the medieval period, but the idea of building shops like that is considerably later. In particular, it took off in Tokyo at the beginning of the Meiji period, and it was a response to concern about fire and the damage that fire could cause spreading through a timber-built, densely packed city. The thing they wanted to do was to rebuild it all in brick. Already Westerners were coming in at this stage, and they had already started, in fact, where they could, they were beginning to produce bricks, and you get the Ginza Brick Town, the first building of Ginza in brick, is already taking place. But most people can't run to brick. There isn't enough available. So what they did was to build them in plastered storehouse form. And this is part of central Tokyo. This is around Nihonbashi. This is the Mitsui Bank. So this is sort of the area where Mitsui Honkan and the Mitsukoshi Department Store are at the moment in Tokyo. So that downtown area of Tokyo was all Misegura, and that came to an end with the huge Kanto earthquake of 1923, because the Misegura would be effective in keeping out fire, but put an earthquake in front of the fire and they couldn't cope, because what happens when you shake such a building is the timber frame is fine, but all that plastered wall stuck on the front of it hasn't sufficient adhesion if you shake it vigorously, and it all falls off, so fire can get into the building, and that's what happened, and they lost almost everything. And after that, they simply stopped building them, and reinforced concrete became the material of choice from then on, really in Tokyo and in sort of dense urban areas. But there are some of these shop houses still surviving, particularly in a town called Kawagoe, which is in Saitama Prefecture. It has a beautiful area which is actually a designated area, sort of conservation area that you can visit. And there are a couple in Sawara, which you will see the day after tomorrow, but not all that many. This is one of them, a very impressive exterior. And in Ichinomiya, we have these two. If we look at these buildings, this is typical exterior and a section, and this is what you've got here, these big flanged doors. They're on the back because the fear was, this is the house, here's the kitchen. If a fire starts, this is where it's going to start. So, should there be a fire, the idea is you shut these big doors and you seal the joint with mud. They would have a bucket with muddy clay there ready all the time, and then everything beyond that fire break is protected from a fire at the back. That's the theory, and there are a number of these. It makes for a very impressive sort of arrangement within the interior, and you'll be able to have a look at it later, I hope. So that's what we've got here. This is one of these fire doors. This is the zashiki that you are in, taken a few years ago. And this is the first survey that was done of this house in 2005 and put into the report that was produced at that stage, which we were not involved in. This is our resurvey of the building, including the room names that we discovered by talking to a member of the family who had been brought up here. This is the whole structure of the building. And we know that it hasn't changed all that much. We have discovered, among other things, old plans made probably at the time when this was erected, or a little before, which basically show us more or less what we have here. And it's like we're able to see from that which bits have been changed and added to, but also evidence from the actual building helps with that. We have an aerial photograph. This shows the house, and originally its plot went right the way through to the road leading down to the station at the back. Now only half of it belongs to the house. The other half was given to another part of the family, and is now parking space largely, but could perhaps be reunited with this if this place, if we need sort of parking for things which are happening here. Looking at the house and its features, it's a Kantor-style merchant house with an earth floor across the street front. It has a shop range and a residential range. The shop and the residential range have their roofs at right angles to each other and are roofed separately. And the standard module for the design of this building, which is fairly typical for the buildings in this area, or slightly larger because it's a really rather beautifully erected building, is one bay from one post to another. Also, the length of one of these mats is 6 feet and 2 sun, or in Japanese 6 shaku and 2 sun, which is a little bit over 1800 millimeters. So that's the sort of standard bay for the construction of this building, and that's very important in a Japanese structure. I'm going to have to call my talk to an end because my students are going to. But briefly, we have looked at a number of houses, and the grandest are these misegura with their plastered storehouses at the front and the residential building behind. And this one has the residential building, the bit you're sitting in, is actually finer than anything that they have surviving in Kawagoe, which is more famous for its misegura than here. But this building in particular, the residential bit, has been beautifully built. The character and the quality of the timber work is, the carpentry is extremely high, and it's beautifully made, and it's also very spacious. But we have looked at a range of other buildings in this settlement, and we found a pattern. But basically, you have the shop space at the front. Sometimes it's a plastered building, more often it's just a timber frame structure. Sometimes it's single story, sometimes it's two story. Sometimes, as in this sort of case, it's simply a pent roof appended to a more major structure. Then to the rear of that, and usually if this part has its roof running this way, the part at the rear will have its roof running the other way, the residential rooms of the house. And the kitchen area is usually here. This one is too. And then we have a veranda running round the reception rooms at the high end. So the room at this, the middle room, or the rooms closer to the kitchen, tend to be domestic rooms, family rooms, and the ones further back are reception rooms for guest reception, and often facing a little garden. So that's the sort of pattern that we have. Here are the sections of our two misegura. This is Seiyahonke, this is the slightly smaller Ningben misegura around the corner in front of the shrine. That building, which you will see later in the day, has now been refurbished. The house behind it, unfortunately, that was rebuilt, so we don't have the older building on that. But this building has been brought back into use and rented from the owners who live in the house behind, and is now producing kakigori, which is Japanese sort of ice, Japanese ice cream, if you like, or an ice sweet. It's basically ice, and very nice in this hot weather. And they're doing that very well, various other things. So it's a sort of little restaurant, and it's very nice to see that building back in use. The back of it is interesting. This is the front. If you go to the back, you find this. And what is this? Well, when you look at it, it's the outline of a building. This is where the original main house came to the back of the misegura, and you can reconstruct it. So one of my students did. What was it like? We've got an aerial photograph which gives us a sort of hint, and put the aerial photograph together with what we heard from asking people, what do you remember, what was it like? And we came up, to some extent one can reconstruct what's been lost. Then we've got a number of other houses which I will just run through very quickly. We've done surveys of these. Sometimes old plans survive, so it's possible to see what's been changed. This is a single-story shop and living range, Kato Honke. It's a very interesting house, and one of my students is going to show a way of maybe renovating this building in a minute or two and reusing it. What's interesting about this, this is not Suya Honke. This is another house which existed on this street, and this is one of those etchings, basically a sort of a copper plate etching, which business owners, little business owners, were having made. It was a bit like a sort of name card in those days. It was a way of advertising your business. They got them drawn, as I said. I showed you the one for Tamasaki Jinja and also for Kamyoji. And what this shows is a little thatched house, this kind of L-shaped plan, and then some storehouses and so forth further back. It's actually a dead ringer for the Kato Honke. And when I first saw that drawing and I'd seen this house, I thought, oh, it's that one. We've got it. But we hadn't. This is a different house. But what it demonstrates is that the houses vary in scale, but there are certain patterns which recur. They had their layouts for their houses, and once you really look at them, you begin to be able to sort them according to size and sort of money and status and all that sort of thing. But they follow a pattern, and these patterns were fixed by that stage. And the littlest ones are fascinating. This is a number of these little yosemune, so hipped roofs, a hisashi, a pent roof across the front, and a hipped roof runs back. And the most interesting one of those we found is this. A very, you know, from the outside you think, what is this? It was in a terrible state when we first saw it externally. The whole of the shop, however, had been redone. It belonged to a tokoya, a barber. And these are the survey drawings of the building that we did. And this is the front of the shop. Here's the barber with Shida-san. And inside, the interior hadn't been altered, basically, since they redid the shop in the early years of the Showa era, in other words, about 1925-30. So we have almost frozen, as it were, the original mirrors, the original chair, all in leather and brass and so forth, that was all put together in the 1930s, and it's never been changed. So actually, as a record of a 1920s to 30s barbershop, it's a very rare survival. And behind it, the little house is older still, and if you reconstruct it, you've got an earth floored area along the street, and this little thatched roof bit over two rooms, a living room and a reception room, with a little veranda going round it, and a little kitchen area out here. So this is the kind of basic starting point. And there are lots of these, not just in Ichinomiya, along this coast, surviving. And they go back, I think. This is part of that drawing showing the market street in front of Shinchoji in Tokyo, and it's a little thatched building there, which is actually very much like what we've got in Ichinomiya. So I think this is 17th century. These little houses, probably the pattern goes back to them. I'm going to stop now. There are all sorts of things one could say, but I hope I've said enough to give you a sense that we have in this town a range of interesting surviving houses, which it would be nice to keep and put to use, and from them maybe to extend and to try and enhance and perhaps in new build too, to reflect the style that this little town had and the traditional house types of the Kanto area, the shop houses of the Kanto. So I'm going to stop now and let my students briefly introduce their designs. Thank you very much for your attention.
Can I do that? 使えば。あ、今使った。はい。
So the next talk, briefly to introduce it, two of my master's students, Yamaoka-kun and Koto-kun, have basically been looking at two buildings in the town, and they are going to suggest proposals. Now these are not proposals that will probably actually be implemented as such, but just as a design project and also for them to think about and perhaps to helpthe people of Ichinomiya also to think about how these buildings might be used. They're making proposals about how they might renovate them.
Okay. Kalimerasas. Toono mam ine kendo. Heropori sas parakaro.
Okay. Today,I propose about another utilization for historical house, the Honkato house. First, do you know where Honkato is? We are here now, Suya Honke. Please guess, everyone.Which? Where?
The green yellowish one? On the
this?
Yes.
No. Guess? Oh. You.
Red one? Red?
Red?
Red.
Red. Blue?
The red?
Red. No.
The yellow one in the bath?
Yellow?
Yeah.
This?
Yeah, I guess so.
No!
No. The one across the street.
This?
Yeah.
Yes, that's correct. actually, everyone already knows because Honkato is opposite Suya Honke.The Honkato house is opposite Suya Honke. It is said that the plot of Honkato originally belonged to the Saitos of Suya Honke. Mr. Kato bought the land from Mr. Saito because Mr. Kato felt indebted to Mr. Saito. He built the house lower than Suya Honke, with only a low attic over the shop.Suya Honke, the aim is to use the house for a range of activities. We hope it will provide a forum where both local residents and visitors can exchange ideas and find inspiration. Thank you. Thanks to everyone's cooperation.Suya Honke is now ready to begin to fulfill this role. The role of Suya Honke is to provide a forum for revival of the community through direct interaction and shared activities between people. To supplement it, I propose as a new role for Honkato House opposite.A place where people can interact more passively and relax while expanding their consciousness through reading and browsing books, while also enjoy a cup of coffee and a load of cake.Honkato continues selling commodity now. There are a lot of attractive spaces in Honkato. It's now roof plan and perspective of Omoya's section. First, early outside of the mise, Nowadays, it is used as a garage and store. Second, courtyard between Omer and store houses. This is a family yard and garden. Third, the right-hand building is a storehouse. The building on the left was accommodation for servants. My proposal, make new resting area here. Second, remove the existing building and make a new building to be a bakery, bread shop, and informal cafe. Third, remove the extension to the zashiki space and reinstate the open veranda. Fourth, rebuild the structure over the alley. This is new plan. Facade, it's not. And I change the door perspective of facade. And alley, it's now alley. I change only timber frame. Do you want to enter? Third, bakery. It's now. I built a new building and its perspective of bakery. Next is mise in the building. It's now. I make the bookshelf and step floor. Next is upper floor. It's now. It's very low. So it's for kids space. Next, dashiki is it's now. This is perspective of dashiki. You can read the books. And it's engawa. You can be outside or inside. Courtyard. It's perspective of the outside of the bakery. And courtyard 2. It's perspective of the resting area. It's newer. And courtyard 3. It's perspective of courtyard. That's all. Sars Efkari store. Thank you. あっち。 めっちゃあっち。
Hello everyone. I'm a first year student of the first year master's first student from the Moist Labo Lettery. I'd like to pick up two buildings. One is the Hakujuan and the other is Tanaka's. Both of them has a relation to the Tamasaki Shrine. Hakujuan is the office buildings of Tamasaki Shrine, and Tanaka House is a house of the priest in charge of Tamasaki Shrine for a long time. And these two buildings, I think these two buildings is so important buildings, but neither building is now in use. Hakujuan is dismantled, and the parts of the building is sleeping in the warehouse now. And Tanaka House is empty now. The then how can we use these two buildings in future? This is my main theme. I think the use of these two buildings should be considered from the point of the scale of the necessary construction. Now look at from step one. Step one is to use Tanaka House as an inn. This is a map of the Ichinomiya town. This is a station, and we are here now. And here is Tamasaki Shrine, and this is a Tanaka House. This is a site plan of the Tanaka House, and Tanaka House is here. I propose to use this Tanaka House as use as inn. Tanaka House has been used as house until quite recently. This is a plan of the Tanaka House. It has some Japanese style rooms and modern kitchens and old bathroom and two restrooms. This is a interior image of the Tanaka House. So I think it can be used as an inn for families or groups of travelers with a present form. It is a use requiring minimal intervention. I think the use of the old buildings should be begun like this. Step two is to rebuild Hakujuan and use as restaurant. This is a site plan of the Tanaka House, and it has very large site, so I think it is possible to rebuild Hakujuan in this site. I plan to make a garden in the south side of the Tanaka House, and I plan to rebuild Hakujuan here and use as a restaurant. It means to become require some construction to have a kitchen or a backyard space, but the people staying in Tanaka House and travelers and people who lives around here can enjoy the meal in the Japanese traditional atmosphere like this. I think it is important investment. Last step is to add new buildings. This step is a use requiring large scale additional construction. I plan the new buildings here, and this building has three functions. The three functions is like this. First function is connect Hakujuan and Tanaka House. This is the image of the array connect to Tanaka House and Hakujuan. You can go through this array with looking the beautiful garden. I'm talking about this area. Second function is new guest rooms. There is a four guest rooms like this, and the center of them is used for stay space. This is an image of the guest rooms, and this building has new facilities. This is new restrooms, and this is new bathrooms. This is the image of the bathroom. Last function is the entrance and the backyard space for inn and restaurant. And this is the image of the entrance. This side is outside. And the back of the, this space, there is a backyard. This is a whole image of the, this facilities. And this is my, I designed this building. If this proposal is a chance to think about the future of the using of old buildings, I'm happy. Thank you for your attention.
The next discussion is from Kaito-san, who works for MOBA Architects, who have been, as I said earlier, doing a lot of the survey work with us and have also been involved in designing, for instance, parts of the shop here. And she'll be talking about their activities in connection with trying to reuse and repair and record the old buildings.
Hi, my name is Ichiko Kaito. I'm working at an architect studio in Tokyo. It's called MOBA Architects. Mainly we work with historic building in Eastern Japan. So, I'm sorry, I'm not good English speaker and I give presentation with reading papers. So, we both started to become involved with Ichinomiya in 2009. And Shida-san asked us to record and research the framing members of Tamasaki Jinja. So we recorded parts of the building with Professor Morris, that Professor Morris told already. So the last one, the top left photo, that picture is an old shrine office. It was taken about 8 years ago. The picture below shows us recording the details of posts from the building after it was dismantled. The Japanese traditional wooden building can be dismantled, damaged areas replaced, and the building rebuilt. We change only damaged part. It's a good way to learn and teach building skills. So now let me tell you about the NPO Sasuga Ichinomiya. It was established in 2008. It is a non-profit organization mostly consisting of local people. This NPO is working to protect the local culture and to transmit the culture to the next generation. There's some activities of them, like revival of the market near the Tamasaki Shrine, or and preservation and handing down traditional culture like performing arts or crafts for young people. After the recording of the old shrine office, our architect's office and the Morris Laboratory of Chiba University have continued to cooperate with NPO on the recording, conservation, and possible use of cultural assets in Ichinomiya. This house, the Siya Honke, is one of the buildings we have researched in the project. Now our project is being supported by a subsidy from the Japanese Agency for Cultural Affairs and Ministry of Education. Before I talk about this project, I want to explain a little about the system for protecting historic buildings in Japan. So this is a system of Japanese cultural properties. The categories of cultural properties include building, fine arts, music, landscapes, particular skills, and more. Today, I shall talk only about these related to architecture. this part. With regard to the protection of historical building under the law, we have the systems shown here. The first, designated cultural properties are designated at national level by the Japanese government or locally by prefectures or cities. So these cultural properties are repaired following detailed investigation. And National Register Tangible Cultural Properties are category established in 2004 to prevent demolition of many historical buildings. Under this system, the subsidies available for building repair were lower than for nationally designated building. But the regulations governing use and repair are not so strict. Basically, these systems allow the changes to the interior to make the building easy to use. When a building is over 50 years old and it is judged to have retained its historical character and value, the building's owner can apply to register the building with the government under the scheme. And this third one, nationally designated important preservation districts for groups of historical buildings. The purpose of this system is to protect the building that survived to constitute a historically significant group. So, and the designations under other laws or regulations are also possible. For instance, these are. And each prefecture and city has its own list of designated or registered cultural properties. And now the concept of cultural properties is much broader than it used to be. Nowadays, systems are recognizing and supporting cultural assets of different kinds at the level of given city or locality is better developed than it was. The basic idea is to make it possible to conserve cultural assets regardless of whether they are tangible or intangible, with the aim of improving local culture. There is recognition that all elements of local culture are closely related. Our use of the cultural property system for this project is based on this idea. So this is our using system. The Agency of Cultural Affairs give a subsidy to help each locality to promote local culture and cultural activities in the future. There are three kinds of subsidy. We are using this number one. And in this support system, these things are required, like provision of information and development of human resources, or passing down cultural heritage to the next generation. So our activities have to satisfy these criteria. But actually, these are what we want to do. In this system, the term cultural assets allows us to include things whether or not they are designated or registered officially. I think it's a good thing because then local people can decide for themselves what they think is important in local area. Satsuga Ichinomiya and Maurice Labor and Mobile Architects applied for a subsidy and the project started 2013. We are doing these things in the project this year, like researching and making reports and preservation and use of cultural assets around Tamasaki Shrine. Moba and the Maurice Laboratory has concentrated on recording history building in this project. So now I shall tell you about our work on historic buildings in Ichinomiya over these 3 years. First, we started finding out how many old buildings left in Ichinomiya City. We judged the age of building from this exterior, and we have marked on the map like this. next from the building we checked, we selected some buildings that look especially old or interesting or were recommended by local people. We got permission to make a detailed survey from the owner of each building. We recorded the plans and sections of the building and we investigated its structure and history. So first we do survey by hand and later we make a drawing by computer. Using the results of these surveys, we are now trying to apply for some of the buildings, including this Tsuyahonke, to be registered as National Tangible Cultural Properties. So if a building is registered, we can get financial support from the government, and the building will gain publicity and be known by people. So here you are can see old photos of this Tsuyahonke house, taken from albums put together in the past by people who lived in the house, or others in the community who have kindly made them available to us. Some of them were taken over 100 years ago. These visual materials and diaries or other records are of greater increasing historical value. They bring the past to life. We can see how the house was used and meet the people who actually lived in. We also interviewed members of families when we surveyed the buildings, and their testimony is also very important way of bringing the building to life. Through our project, the actual building has been brought into use again. I shall now talk about how we started organizing the reuse of Tsuyahonke, this house. We think the present Tsuyahonke was built at the very end of the 19th century. So some material was reused and must be older. When it was built, the store at the front was a shop selling marine products, especially dried bonito. It's called katsuobushi in Japan, this size, and we make soup from katsuobushi. And more recently, in the last decades of 20th century, the store part was used as a sewing school. However, in the last few years, the building had fallen out of use, and there are danger that it might be demolished. This house is an important survival in Ichinomiya, and until it fell out of use, it has been well maintained and looked after. So we wanted to conserve this house somehow. The only way to save the building from demolition was to purchase it. So Shida-san decided to buy the house, with the aim of conserving it for use as a center for local activities. Now the house is a base for the NPO Sasuga Ichinomiya and is being repaired to serve as a cultural center. When we plan the restoration of the history building, typically these points require consideration. The repairing damage so that the building is safe to use, and maintaining the quality of the original building, and passing the building and its story to the next generation. So to start using Tsuyahonke, Moba and Marisla first noted the voices of the members of the NPO and made a plan accordingly. These points summarize our understanding of the meaning of Tsuyahonke's history, like conserving the form of the shop building and the domestic range, and explaining the history of the house and the role of the Welsh merchant family who built it in the history of Ichinomiya, and conserving the design of the building and the garden to show the high cultural standards of Ichinomiya. And this is our policy for use of Tsuyahonke. It's using this building well as a place for the provision of local cultural information and a place to communicate Japanese culture. This is the first zoning plan we made. In the plan, the shop building is used as a cafeteria and a shop for local food. In the dwelling building, the large Japanese room is to be used as a meeting room, and the small room is to be used as a library for historical archives. Now the plan has changed a little. Now a new kitchen that is compatible with current legal requirements is provided in the extension. This room is added later. We undertook further investigation to decide details of renovation and repair. So we researched more. This is a drawing showing which parts are damaged. The colored parts are damaged areas. We also checked the interior. From this investigation, we made decisions about which repairs should have priority. For example, roof leaks are high priority, and damage to the facade should be repaired quickly because it is the public face of the building. And the drawing shows traces of changes on the building members. So this is a part of the building, this block. If we examine these traces of alternation to the flame, we can reconstruct the original form of the building and how it has been altered. Used by other surveys, through this research, we established the significance of the building and decide which parts we should conserve or restore and which can be changed without compromising the building historical value. So we are proceeding with repairs such as the replacement of the doors at the front of the shop. The carpenters have removed the parts that were added later. These were changed to windows in the late 20th century. But we are restoring an earlier arrangement based on old photos. In Japan, sometimes restoration can cost more than new building. And many people tend to think building new is better than using an old building. But there is really no substitute for a good building retained in its original context. So we are repairing Seihonke, hoping the house will be a good place for people to encounter the local history and culture of Ichinomiya. At the end, let me introduce the booklet and the brochures we have made in connection with the project. So first the report. From what we have discovered through our work on the project, we have made reports. These are made as a record to tell local people and other researchers what we have discovered. And we also give lecture about our research of findings. It's held in Seihonke. And this is a pamphlet. Students at Chiba University have made these 3D models. Usually, it's difficult to see inside someone's house, but this shows the character of each building and its connection with the history of Ichinomiya. So this is a map that shows where the cultural assets of Ichinomiya are located, and recommended routes for walks around the area and indicated as well. This map provides comprehensive information about the history of culture in Ichinomiya. Everyone can get this map at the station and in some of the local shops. And in Seihonke also, you can get. Please check it later. So besides Xiaohongge, there are several historic buildings that we research, which are beginning to be reused. For example, the Takaharake, the ice cream shop, is also reused. We hope there will soon be more. And through surveys and events, we have met many local people and talked. We hope our activities will help people understand more about Ichinomiya's history and culture, and contribute to the quality of life and the vibrancy of the local community. Thank you for your listening.